Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strawstown Rod and Gun Club.
And good evening, everybody. Welcome to Just Say Sports, another rousing, exciting edition of Just Say Sports. We are live September 24th from the BCTV studios across from beautiful Albright College. My name's Rob Galtier. With me again this week, Chris Barto. Chris, welcome.
Rob, great to be here.
Great to be
here.
A lot to talk about. We both had laundry lists of stuff. You know, Yes. We've got our usual Gabe Kapler complaints, which we'll get to at some point. NFL yesterday. We've got Penn State, Ohio State. We could touch on that game coming up, and what was pretty much a sluggish start for Penn State on Friday. Maybe a look-ahead situation. I don't know. A lot of good NFL action. NBA preseason's coming up. So lots to talk about. So let's touch on the NFL. Actually, 2 weeks we can really comment on since we weren't around last week. NFC East really doesn't look like anything's shaking out as of yet. Some good and some bad from all the teams in the NFC East.
I would agree. It's still too early. Maybe after 4 or 5 weeks we'll know a little better. But nice to see the Eagles pull out another win. And again, we talk about it all the time. You don't get style points. It's wins and losses that matter. And Frank Reich knew what they were going to try to do against them. So, you know, that doesn't make it any easier for you. And I think Carson Wentz coming back obviously energized the team, the fan base, and just having him out there ultimately helped them win.
There's no question they need to get Alshon Jeffrey. They need to get some of these weapons back. But my biggest concern, and it really showed up last year, especially when you saw it in the Super Bowl, the defense is great at the link.
Mm-hmm.
The defense is very average on the road, and the numbers proved it out last year. There was almost a 10-point swing on their home and road. They make plays at home. They give up yardage, but they make plays at home. They seem to struggle on the road. You saw it in the Super Bowl where they couldn't stop Brady at all until Brandon Graham got the strip. And then Tampa Bay just ate them up alive. So it'll be real interesting this week as they go into Tennessee against an offense that's struggling themselves.
The other team that was like that last year is the Vikings. Exact same scenario. Great at home and not so much on the road. So that is something to watch. Obviously, they need to be more consistent.
Well, and if they have any interest at all in potentially trying to win a Super Bowl, they really need the home field advantage. And that proved out last year. That was a huge, huge key, getting Minnesota at home.
No question.
That could have been a completely different game if they were playing that on the road. But is this team good enough as it is right now to win enough games where they get the home field advantage? Because I'll tell you right now, the LA Rams look really good.
They do, and got a gift with an unfortunate injury to Garoppolo. So the threat to them in the West really isn't there, I don't think. Seattle's average, the Cardinals, terrible. So I see the Rams running the table in that division. That's 6 wins right there. And
they get the Eagles at home. They get the Vikings at home. So even their schedule of playing, you know, the number one teams across the board, they get, you know, the tough ones at home. So
it will be difficult to steal the advantage from them. But going to LA, look at what the Eagles fans did there last year, the way they show up. So I would say LA is a different animal than Green Bay or Chicago or some hostile environment like that, for sure. So yeah, even if they don't get it, I think they can absolutely win in LA if they had to.
Well, they did beat him there last year, Nick Foles coming in at the end, and the Rams did lose they had a home playoff game and were pretty much handled by the Falcons. I just think that 1 year of experience for this Rams team, and they certainly have an explosive offense.
Ton of weapons.
Yeah, a ton of weapons, and a great coach. You should know that.
Yeah, I wish he was still in Washington.
Former Redskins offensive coordinator who drove the Eagles crazy. There was a reason why the Redskins won 5 games in a row against the Eagles, and it was mainly him and, of course, Kirk Cousins. Speaking of Kirk Cousins, big game yesterday, Vikings against the Bills. Your man came through.
Yeah, the conditions were just terrible. I think there was at least 5 mile an hour wind. The temperature was under 70 and the barometric pressure was high. So Kirk had his difficulties with the Bills yesterday. He did.
55 pass attempts and still didn't get 300 yards. Let's face it, the game against Green Bay, that pass he threw where the two Packers missed the interception and it fell in Thielen's hands. I mean, yeah. And they made Cousins out to how he threaded the needle.
Mm-hmm. I know, that's everyone's lovable Kirk. He's the greatest thing since
sliced bread. Hey, you got Alex Smith now, Redskins fan. You got Alex Smith. Redskins, obviously a much improved team. Tough game against the Colts. Colts are a legitimate defense.
Really disappointing game in week two. Going home for your home opener and just did not show up at all. And Jay Gruden's excuse was he couldn't get into a rhythm calling plays. Okay, to me that means you didn't work hard enough and or you're not that good a coach. So your pick.
You know what I'll give Gruden? The Eagles struggled getting into a rhythm yesterday. I think it's kind of that zone defense. They're not going to give up anything deep. But finally, in that long drive to end the game, the Eagles just said, the hell with it, we're going to run the ball. And they ran the ball and ran the ball. And that's what you got to do. Be patient.
And Adrian Peterson had an incredible week one against the Cardinals and was non-existent in week two.
Yeah, they fell behind and really didn't try to run the football. That makes it difficult. Just Say Sports is the program. Feel free to join in the conversation, 610-378-0426. Cowboys, Dak Prescott, we've said it before. How long do they go on pretending that this guy is the future?
That is 5 straight games under 200 yards passing, which is by far the longest current streak in the league. So I hope he keeps playing.
Oh, yeah. But they've, you know, there was this, I guess, a glimmer of hope because their defense is pretty good this year. The Cowboys do have a good defense, but my goodness, they were behind the best offensive line in football 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. They are a very average line now. He doesn't have that confidence. They kind of need, I think they need to start over. They need to find a quarterback and kind of start that whole thing over.
They do, and I believe Jason Garrett will be on his way out this year as well. Yeah. His time has come and gone. So hopefully no changes in Dallas because we like the way they're playing right now.
And the Giants pick up a much-needed win after an 0-2 start. When do we finally say Bill O'Brien really isn't that good of a coach?
Very surprising win by the Giants, in my opinion. I didn't see that coming at all, and I totally agree. He's got to be on the hot seat right now. 0-3 start. Deshaun Watson looked extremely frustrated, the parts of that game that I saw. And talk about having rhythm. They had none.
No.
Hopkins was non-existent, and they got a garbage touchdown at the end to make it closer than it was. So I agree with your point about Bill O'Brien. He seems to be a better coordinator than head coach.
Well, it seemed like they double-teamed Hopkins, and there was just, you know, and that's Watson's first look. Then you got him going to his second and his third looks, and that's not his strength at this point in his career, but only a second year. Patriots, I said last year when the Eagles beat them, I really believed they cut the head off the snake, that this was the end of the Patriots era. And so far, now, of course, I say this and they're going to run off 8 straight, but they are way off their game right now.
Zero pass rush, zero running game. Tom Brady's starting to look his age. They desperately need to get Edelman back, and who knows what Josh Gordon will do for them, if anything. Gronkowski, pretty much a non-factor last night. So they do look very vulnerable, I would say. I totally agree with that.
Trading Brandon Cooks, a huge mistake.
No doubt.
I mean, I think he was a guy that spread the field for them, but that's just an atrocious loss to a guy who has looked terrible as a defensive coordinator with the Patriots, I thought, the whole second half of last season. Mm-hmm. And then the start this year looked terrible. to just completely shut down the Patriots.
Yeah, he frankly outcoached Belichick last night.
Yeah, absolutely. So kind of went around there on the NFL. Good stuff on your part. Way to come prepared. I appreciate that.
Hey, I try my best.
Okay, Penn State, Ohio State, game of the year, Big Ten, college football. Obviously a must-win game for Penn State if they have any hopes of finally making that new playoff system. This is a real good Ohio State team. Coach is a jerk, but real good Ohio State team.
They are. They're very tough to defend. They can spread the field on you. They have athletes everywhere and a quarterback who looks better than any that they've had of the last five. So it's a tough test for sure. You have to hope the home field advantage is a factor. Some penalties on Ohio State, and they need to force some turnovers. If they don't, I don't like Penn State's chances.
Well, this is the whiteout game. Magical things tend to happen at the whiteout. They usually play much better defense on whiteout games than they do other games, which they need because, frankly, right now they look a little lost on the defensive side of the ball.
You're right. The thing about the defense is in this game, they have one series to figure it out. All the other games this year, they've had a quarter, a half, and then they just wear them down and they figure it out eventually and shut the other team down. That can't happen with the Ohio State game. They gotta be on their game and have the game plan of their life from the first play of scrimmage in this one, or they're gonna be in trouble.
Yeah.
The thing about the local guy, Jan Johnson, I noticed last week when he was playing, at least for the first half or so, I don't think they gave up points. And then when Parsons came in, the other team was going down the field and scoring. So I thought that was interesting. I've seen Parsons chasing the play a lot so far, being out of position and just being inexperienced basically as a linebacker at this point in his young career. So I think that's something interesting to watch.
Yeah, it will be interesting. Yeah, you can't make mistakes against Ohio State. Watch the TCU-Ohio State game a week ago, and I think that's the only real test they have. Now, TCU's not world beaters. I mean, Texas.
They showed that this week, yeah.
Yeah, Texas handled. But you can get big plays on Ohio State.
Mm-hmm.
You can break off big plays, but you've got to be aggressive, and TCU was very aggressive. I think this Penn State offense can be aggressive when they want to be.
Yeah, I'm not worried about them being shut down by Ohio State's defense at all. The offensive line's playing great. McSorley looks good, and Sanders had a breakout game now. And I'm anxious to see what Tommy Stevens does this week because you know they've been having that in their back pocket until this game coming up. Mm-hmm. He's healthy. They haven't shown anything, so I can't wait to see what the offensive coordinator does with Stevens in this game as a way to surprise Ohio State.
They got the running game going. Ohio State's a 3.5-point favorite. I thought that was a little steep. You didn't seem to think so. You thought that was a good number. I was thinking more lines of 2, 2.5. So that surprised me a little. But what really surprised me was the total. And again, it didn't surprise you. What was 72?
Yes.
Penn State Ohio State game with a total of 72. That's Oklahoma State Texas Tech territory. That's not Penn State Ohio State.
You're right. My how the game has changed pretty much in every sport in the last 30 years. But I can see both offenses in the 30s easily in this game. So you do that, you're getting close to 70 or plus. So,
well, look at the last two games, and correct me if I'm wrong. I believe last year Penn State got out in front, had a shot to run away with it. Ohio State reeled them in 2 years ago. Ohio State had the game pretty much won in the block punt, and Penn State was able to turn that around. So getting off to a good start, you'd like to, but it really didn't help out the last 2 weeks. Ohio State, you think, ends up winning?
I do. Fairly close game, but it wouldn't surprise me if they won by 10 or 11. How about you?
I think Ohio State's the better team at this point. It's always something special about those night whiteout games. I give Penn State a legitimate chance. Like I said, I didn't think the spread would be 3.5. I think it comes down to the final possession either way. I'd probably say Ohio State, but it wouldn't shock me. I hate to play the middle of the fence, but I think it's that close of a game mm-hmm. where it doesn't surprise me if Penn State does pull off the upset. But they've got to play better than they have. You can't put the effort you did against Illinois against Ohio State and expect to compete.
Yeah, totally agree with that. It would be interesting to see where Penn State is ranked if they do win.
I just want to stay on football 1 second, and I like to throw kudos out because I've been tough on them mm-hmm. In the past. Berks Catholic. What Berks Catholic has done this year with their schedule, and I know it's a lot of it's difficult because teams won't schedule them, but when you have the amount of talent, the players that are coming in, the players that are, you know, starting at a young age and going through the Berks Catholic has a tremendous football program, and for them to step out, play Central Dauphin, McDonough, Malvern Prep, Exeter. Granted, they went 2-2 in those games, but they were playing. You know, Malvern Prep is one of the best teams in the state. McDonough's an outstanding program. Maryland, who travels the East Coast to play teams. Mm-hmm. You know, Exeter is always competitive in Section 1, and Central Dauphin is just an absolute beast. So kudos to them. That schedule is going to help them down the stretch. And although they're inexperienced in the defensive backfield and kind of hurt them a little against Malvern Prep, mm-hmm. that's going to help those guys come district and state. So kudos to Berks Catholic for that schedule, because no one's going to remember whether you go 10-0 or 9-2 or 11-0 or 9-2. They're going to remember what you do in the playoffs, and I think that's really going to help Berks Catholic.
It's a great point you make, and it's nice to give teams credit for doing what they should do.
Yep. Hey, we've got time. We've bitten our tongue. Favorite part of the show every 2 weeks to get our frustrations out on the Phillies manager, Gabe Kapler, the guy who invented baseball. Abner Doubleday, now Gabe Kapler's going to reinvent baseball. They're going to put him in the Baseball Hall of Fame because he's doing things that are different and make a lot of sense.
Have you noticed my mannerisms tensed up?
I just think about the guy in his press conferences and I get angry, and it's I record extra at the end of the games just so I can see what stupid things he says at the end of the game, and it drives me crazy. And I don't know why I do it.
Yeah, you should spare yourself from that. But horrendous job, in my opinion. Like I've said before, I believe if Dusty Wathan managed this team, the outcome would have been much different. Kapler's 500 different lineups got the very least possible production out of these players. I totally believe that.
And I said this to you before the show. He actually became a worse manager, if possible, when he had a 40-man roster.
Absolutely. He's so unorthodox and driven by his iPad. It's just ridiculous. There's no excuse for it at the major league level.
I don't know which was my favorite move, but was it pinch hitting for Scott Kingery in the second inning of a game, or putting in this one's still my favorite because I just remember the comment by John Kruk. Taking Justin Bour out at the beginning of the third after he had a double and a walk, but the Phillies were losing 2-1 for defensive purposes. He said, I never really saw a guy taken out of the game for defensive purposes when they were losing. And this was in the beginning of the third.
Oh.
So before we go on that, we have a caller on the line. Hello, good evening, and welcome to Just Say Sports.
Hi, fellas. How are you?
Great. How are you?
Doing good.
Very well. I've been waiting for this conversation. I have so much to say, but we don't have enough time. But anyhow, I totally agree with everything you fellas have said. And I just want to quickly run down a list, and then I'm going to get off the phone.
Oh, good. Please do. We both have lists. And I'm sure our stuff's on your list, mm-hmm. so go ahead.
I was never for the acquisition of Carlos Santana. He just should have stayed making records, because when you got him, it moved Rhys Hoskins from first to the outfield. He's not an outfielder. It screwed everything up and limited the amount of moves you had on a chessboard, including Scott Kingery. And I'll get to Scott in a moment.
Outstanding point. Go ahead.
And, well, I'll get to him now. And one point, during every Phillies broadcast, they give a minor league report. And they give a glowing report about the minor leagues, which is well-deserved. They've got an outstanding minor league. Then what the heck happens once they get to Philadelphia? And this is not just this year. It's historic when you really think about it. They just kind of hit the jackpot during those early to mid-2000s with those core three or core four guys.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing that they didn't mess that up, too. But anyhow, regarding Scott Kingery, I look at him, and last year, and even I think at the beginning of this year, I called in and thought that he was really an outstanding player for the present and the future, and I still do to some degree if they don't just get rid of him. But I liken it to a substitute teacher in a high school, where you take a guy who is a certified social studies teacher, but you one day put him in math, and then you don't have him sub at all, and then the next time he subs, you put him in science, and then the next time he comes in, you put him in home ec, and then maybe 2 days later, you put him into social studies, and then at the end of the year, the principal gets together with the superintendent and goes, well, how about that Johnson kid? I don't know. He really wasn't that impressive. He wasn't that good a social studies teacher.
That is a great analogy, because they never put him in social studies.
He's really never played second base, which he is. He's a second baseman
and a good one.
Mm-hmm.
And a good one, but they played him at, now we're going to try him at short. Well, he's got the potential to be a great shortstop. What about J.P. Crawford? Well, he's good, too, and then they've been jerking around J.P. Crawford.
Well, no, they put him at third, and he never played third before.
Right, third, and then more recently, they've taken Carlos Santana, moved it from first to third, and I'm sure he's thinking, well, hey, guys, I've played it a little bit in my life, maybe a little league and in the major leagues, but I'm a first baseman. And they're just putting Aaron Altair. Am I going to play, and where am I going to play? Is it left field? I'm not a left fielder, guys. I'm a right fielder. And then Herrera, I thought the comments yesterday by the broadcasting crew was that he looked like a man who was standing in quicksand.
Yeah, yeah.
First base. Anyhow, I'll get off and let you cut.
I appreciate those, and I got to go back to the Carlos Santana at third base, because the biggest game of the year, first game, gets the Atlanta Braves. They got a sweep. They score a run in the first. There's an energy in the dugout. He puts on his shift, has Carlos Santana playing third base. Now he's playing shortstop on the shift, and Freddie Freeman hits a hard grounder, should be a double play ground ball. Santana boots it. Then Reese Hoskins makes a bad play at first, and just watching this team defensively. In that game, Aaron Altair, who's not a left fielder, misplays a fly ball, then takes a thousand steps to get to a routine single, which turns into a double and the game-winning run. And to top it off, Gabe Kapler puts his absolute worst relief pitcher in the last month in down one when Sir Anthony Dominguez hadn't pitched in the most important game of the year. But Gabe Kapler is a genius, going to reinvent baseball. Abner Kapler.
He's an evil genius.
Gabe Doubleday. They're the same person. Why don't you throw just a couple off your list?
Well, we talked. Basically, there was no energy in general. Jake Arrieta was the only one to call anybody out during
and got in trouble for it.
Yeah. The one that really bothers me is that Gabe Kapler is a complete dud defending his players, and he never got tossed from a game once.
No.
Look at Aaron Boone. He intentionally did it a couple times for the Yankees this year. And Martinez even did it in Washington for Harper. But not Gabe. Nope, I need to stick around so I can manage the whole game. He just doesn't get it, period. Why don't you give one of yours?
Well, how about Roman Quinn batting third? Where Roman Quinn's two places in the lineup this year were either third or ninth.
Mm-hmm.
And someone still hasn't explained to me why it makes sense to have a position batter play ninth. because it seemed like any time they had a rally going, the pitcher was coming up in the A-hole.
Yep.
Which I don't get. No, you can't convince me. Rhys Hoskins batting second all year. The one guy who's capable of driving in runs is batting behind Cesar Hernandez, who struck out in the first.
And that's purely analytics driven. And the bottom line is the analytics are great, but is that analytics of your team, of your player's DNA? No, it's not. It's a general piece of data you're looking at. Rhys Hoskins wasn't meant to hit second. He never has in his life. Now he's a 240-something hitter, of which he never came close to hitting either.
Yeah.
We don't have the time. These are basic ones we're giving. They never retaliated once against a team who threw against Hoskins and Odubel. Well,
you know what's scary? They're firing every hitting coach basically in the minor league system. The minor leagues where they're succeeding because they're not doing the whole launch angle thing. The thing that is absolutely killing them at the major league level.
Yeah.
This launch angle, they're trying to get it top to bottom. We're going to be stuck with Gabe Kapler next year, but at least every 2 weeks it'll give us something to talk about.
It will.
Chris, thanks for coming again.
Great to be
we
here.
We will see you in a couple weeks. Thanks again for supporting us, Strausstown Rod and Gun Club. This was Just Say Sports. Good night.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strausstown Rod and Gun Club.